Welcome back, everyone, to the second part of the lecture talking about periodic analysis, which is part of periodic structures in the course of dynamics of a structure. Wow, that was quite long introduction, right? As a matter of fact, we have reached a point in the previous video where we identified the existence of what we called an eigenvalue problem. Now we are relating the inputs of one cell to the inputs of the adjacent cell using an eigenvalue problem, and the eigenvalues are those of this a matrix, which we will call T. T is not the transfer matrix. Notice here, just to make things clearer, the transfer matrix related the inputs to the outputs. Okay? But what we have here is something that relates the inputs of one cell to the input of the adjacent cell, and we introduced a negative sign here. So this is this what we have here is not the transfer matrix per se. It's this row actually in the transfer matrix was multiplied by minus one to obtain the matrix T that we are using here. Anyway, this is just a little bit of a detail. Let's proceed. Now we have an eigen, we are going to handle the eigenvalue problem here, in which e to the mu is actually equal to the eigenvalues of the T matrix. We may call these eigenvalues lambda. However, we have a special name for the mu that we are going to be using from now on, the propagation factor. Remember, we mentioned in the previous lecture that the relation between the input and the input of the adjacent cell will be related by this number. This number, which we call the propagation factor, if, for example, it's real and positive, then we should expect that the values of the inputs of the adjacent cell will be more than the values of the inputs of this cell. This usually doesn't happen in nature, especially in mechanical vibrations, since, as a matter of fact, everything decays. We haven't here considered any damping, but damping is all over the place. But this is just to illustrate. There is another interesting characteristic of the T matrix, that its eigenvalues always appear in pairs. This actually phenomena is quite interesting. If this is not the case, then we can evaluate mu by taking the log or the natural logarithm of lambda, from which we get mu. This is straightforward. Everybody can do that. But this actually will not allow us to see some of the characteristics. However, since we always have them in pairs, if they are only two, they're just one pair, but you will always have them in even numbers, 2, 4, 6, 8. If this is the case, now we, instead of using mu and e to the minus mu, we may use the relation of the hyperbolic cosine to say that the hyperbolic cosine of mu is equal to lambda plus 1 over lambda all over 2. This is this comes from the definition of the hyperbolic cosine, which you can review in any mathematics book. So now we can obtain mu, which is a function of omega, as you may remember. All T, actually, all the matrix T and the dynamic stiffness matrix or the transfer matrix also, they are all functions of the excitation frequency. So mu is going to be a function of the excitation frequency. Lambda is going to be a function of the excitation frequency. Everything we have here is a function of the excitation frequency. From this, we will obtain a value for mu, which generally may appear as a complex number. Any complex number can be expressed as a real part plus an imaginary part. Okay, let's take this concept, this snapshot, and look at, okay, what's going to happen in the vibration, what's going to happen to the wave propagating in the structure, if mu is real or mu is imaginary or if it's a complex number. In the case of having lambda greater than 1 or less than minus 1, we have the other part of it, or the companion part of it, which will be 1 over lambda, is going to be equal to also 1 greater than 1 or less than minus 1, or the reciprocal will be always between 1 and minus 1. Anyway, if we have this as real numbers, then as a matter of fact, you're going to always get mu as a positive number. Of course, remember that mu may be a positive or a negative number. The cosine is a symmetric function, or the hyperbolic sine. This function will give you either plus or minus a value. We usually use the plus for the purpose of drawing graphs and just lecturing. As a matter of fact, the one that's really active in the structure is the negative one, because things are decaying. Okay, so this is a common thing that we're always using. But anyway, if we focus only on the positive number we have here, actually, if lambda is greater than 1, we'll always get a positive number if it is greater than 1. If it is a negative number, if the lambdas are negative, then we actually have a negative number inside the arc cosine, or the arc hyperbolic cosine. The negative number there cannot exist, because the hyperbolic cosine is a function that's always greater, that always produces a number that's greater than 1. However, we can just take that minus sign outside the hyperbolic cosine, and it will appear in the form of I pi. So just the minus 1 will always give us a constant I pi, and the rest in here will be similar to the previous relation. Okay. Don't worry. This isn't everything. We are going to apply every single step we're having here. We're going to apply them on different structures. I'm just trying to explain the general procedure as we are together at this point. Okay. In this case, in which mu is a real number, or mu is a complex number with a constant imaginary part, then we will have what we call a stop band. This means that the intensity of the wave will be decaying along the cell. Thus, what's getting in will not all get out. Some of it will be lost inside the cell, so the coming cell will actually see a smaller input. Okay, what happens if if lambda is a real number that's lying between, if the real part of lambda lies between minus 1 and 1? If the real part of lambda lies between 1 and minus 1, we will have values of mu changing from 0 to pi using an inverse cosine function. That's the interesting part. The cosine part, actually, this is the part we are not interested in. This is what's called a pass band. It means that there isn't any decay that's going to happen between the input of this cell and the input of the adjacent cell. Rather, what's going to happen is just a phase shift. There is no decay, no losses. So, and mu will be a pure imaginary number. Okay? Let's now stop talking about hypothetical structures, hypothetical settings. We will go to, in the next part of the lecture, to talk about periodic discrete systems. Discrete systems are one that are composed of masses and springs. So, to summarize here, the two parts of this lecture, or this part of the lecture, in which we talked about periodic structures, we showed that there can be a relation between the input and the output. And then we used that relation to create a relation between the input of a cell and the input of the adjacent cell. Then we assumed that the input will be, the relation between the two inputs will be an exponential relation, which we hope will be decaying. Then we obtained the relation, the constant of, or the coefficient of the exponential relation using an eigenvalue problem. Then we investigated what's going to happen in each case. What will happen if the eigenvalues are real? What will happen if the eigenvalues are complex? What will happen if the eigenvalues are greater than 1 or less than 1? Now we are going to take all this and apply it to a simple system, a discrete spring mass system. Later, we will use the same procedure, which will be hopefully clearer when we go through the spring mass problem. We use the same procedure for bars and then for beams. And later in another lecture, we will introduce periodic plates. I hope now that our path is clear and that you will follow with me in these videos. See you next video, inshallah.